Okay, so welcome back, dear students. In the last lecture, we discussed about some of the classifications and some brief introductory aspects with regards to disaster management. So let us start today's session with where we left, that is disaster preparedness. So what is disaster preparedness? It is an ongoing multi-sectoral activity which is an integral part of the national system responsible for developing plans and programs for disaster management, prevention, mitigation, response, rehabilitation, and reconstruction. Now, let us try to understand this definition. The terms which I have mentioned in the last part of this definition, I have already discussed in the previous two lectures. Next, building up an integral part. Building up disaster preparedness as an integral part of the national system responsible for developing plans and programs. So how this is important? See, if in our situation that we have learned from in the previous experiences, with the gradual span of time, we learned that in a state of natural calamity and in which a huge infrastructure, a huge population, and some other political, sociological, and economical aspects are related. So disaster preparedness from the part of the state. Whenever I say the state, that means the government of India or the government of state. I don't refer to the state governments. So the responsibility develops on the part of state as our soul of constitution also says that the state should protect its people. So definitely to protect our people and to help us, it becomes an responsibility also for the state to prepare some development plans and programs for disaster management, and which includes first of all the four pillars of disaster management as well as reconstruction, rehabilitation, etc. So, coming on to the first part, which says that disaster preparedness is an ongoing multi-sectoral activity. Now, what does this mean? What does multi-sectoral means? Multi-sectoral basically means that in the process of disaster preparedness, maybe from prevention to rehabilitation and reconstruction, all the sectors play an important role. What sectors are we talking? May it be various types of industries, may it be policing sector, may it be health departments, and even the educational institutions. Each and everyone, even the individual local communities, they all play an important role in disaster preparedness. And it has been ever since our school times, if you remember, there have been various sessions, and even in the till I remember in the subject of geography there was a considerable part for disaster management, and even in the social science subject. So a considerable effort has been given by the state to educate the people, to make them aware. Various drills have been conducted at various levels from time to time. Further, various methods are told. Like if you can recall from your school time, you can recall that we learned that during a case of earthquake, what are the methods we should do, we should follow. Should we stand near the wall? Should we go below a bed or a table? Or should we use something? Or should we directly go, first of all, try to go to an open space outside of the building if it is possible? We learned that we should not use the lifts in case of fire and any natural calamities, let's say fire or earthquake. So these were just a brief introduction and recall on what the many things we learned as a student in our school time. So even today those things hold true, and I hope that most of us definitely remember the topics that we have learned during the school time. So disaster preparedness, as said, it is an ongoing multi-sectoral activity. So now coming to the first word, that is ongoing. So what does ongoing means? That it is a continuous process, okay? That currently also there might be some developments going on, to prevent the disasters and in which multi-sector participation is definitely required. So for example, recently there have been cases in which there have been fires in the industrial places where during the night time some of the laborers were residing. This was the case of our capital Delhi, and the place was in such a, the factory or the industry was in such a location that even the fire brigades, because of their huge size, could not enter those small what we say small narrow roads into those colonies where that factory was working. And due to non-availability of fire brigade there and delay in the system, and also lack of prevention of various lack of measures for various preventive measures in that factory, led to a loss of a huge number of people's death. Okay, so it has never been a good news to hear about any natural calamity, be it tsunami, be it be floods, be it earthquake. As of now, as we are facing, the northeast, that is the state of Assam, is facing huge crisis in the factor of flood, and around 70 people have lost their lives there. So it's never a good news, and we should always be continuously working to prepare ourselves and prepare the various resources which we have towards disaster preparedness, and which will accomplish the goal, the objectives of as a disaster management student as well as disaster management authority. Next, coordination of a variety of sectors to carry out are required for evaluation of risk, adopting standards and regulations, organizing communication and response mechanisms, ensuring all resources ready and easily mobilized, develop public education programs. I've already emphasized on this one. Coordinate information with the news media and disaster simulation exercises. So as I mentioned, various drills have been carried out and are carried out by the state as simulation exercises, where the people of the local community or that particular specific area are trained via live drill in under controlled situation. Now let us discuss the various concepts with regards to evaluation of the risk. Now, evaluation of risk, as I mentioned about earthquake in the previous lecture, if you can recall, I said that earthquakes are caused due to movements, due to slippage, due to maybe due to collision of tectonic plates, or maybe any sort of movement in the tectonic plates lead to a development of earth waves which result in earthquakes. So we need to evaluate various things. We need to evaluate, we do the evaluation of the risk, that what are the potential risks for a particular zone, particular area. I am talking about not just for earthquake, for many other things. Like if we talk about some man-made disasters like terrorism, so we need to evaluate. And evaluation is mostly based upon the public sentiments as well as past experiences, as well as even the global politics, national politics and other things. Many of the things they play a role in the man-made disasters such as terrorism. So for example, the worst disaster man-made in the field of terrorism that our country faced was during the time of the attack on the Taj Hotel at Mumbai. So during that time, the situation was initially totally out of control. Those terrorists went into the hotel. They somehow managed to get into the city via the sea routes. We all are very much aware about all the proceedings that happened later. But now we learned from that disaster. And now whenever you visit any big hotels, these 5-star, 7-star hotels, now the security checks have enhanced multifolds. They don't let you allow your car in without any checks. They don't allow any other type of possibility of risk. So the security concerns have increased over those places. So Evaluation further involves, let us again talk about a very prominent natural disaster, that is earthquake, and also the fires which might occur at any time, at any place. So fires may be due to any presence of inflammable material, and mostly due to gas cylinders. If we talk about residential houses, the fires catch up, and thirdly, due to electrical failures, short circuits. So these are the some of the things which develop into this fire disaster. So we need to evaluate various risks involved. As a civil engineer, we need to consider the integrity of the structure, whether the structure in its current state is safe enough to if any natural or man-made calamity happens. So for example, for evaluation of a already built structure, there are various methods under civil engineering in which we can evaluate the risk capacity of that particular structure. We can find out structural activities. There are various tests. We can classify those tests into two types, that is destructible test and non-destructible test. So what it basically means, destructible test means that we take a part of structure. Let us say this is the frame of the house. These are the columns and beams which I have drawn. So what we do, let us say we have taken a particular sample from this side. This is our sample. We term it as a core. So we take a core and we test it using the various equipments available for compression testing in our labs, and we find what is the structural integrity and structural behavior of this particular section or this particular building as a whole, since it has aged homogeneously. Second type of structural tests are non-destructible tests, in which there is not breakage. We don't take any core outside of this particular structure. We do not take out any material. We have some instruments through which we assess what is the structural strength and integrity of that particular structure. May it be this column, may it be beam, slab, may it be anything. So various instruments are available with us. For example, rebound hammer. For example, ultrasonic tests are available through which, without any destructions, we are able to assess the quality of the structure. We are also aware, I know that most of the students here are from mechanical engineering background, but at least we are aware that during the construction process, there is use of steel bars that is reinforcement. That is the reason we say reinforced concrete. So even we have instruments under NDT, that is non-destructible testing, through which we can assess that let us say a building was constructed in the year 1990, and presently the year is going on 2020, so 30 years have passed, and as we know that steel undergoes corrosion, and due to corrosion its considerable diameter might reduce. So after the span of 30 years, a considerable amount of diameter might a diameter of steel or some of the steel might have been lost in the form of rust. So when designed, it considered the safety, but is it safe now? What were the weather conditions through on which it was exposed? What was the quality of construction which was taken by the contractors or the builders of house? So we need to assess all these things. Next, we also need to assess whether this structure is having some good quality now or not. Okay. Next, we have discussed the first one. Next, adopting standards and regulations. Now there is various standards. For example, let me take I attended a recent course on earthquake, and it was based on earthquake engineering prominently, and also on disaster management, and it was organized by NDMA and one of the NITs. So at there I got to interact with one of the senior officials of disaster management authority of that particular state, and in which he said that many of the buildings which are running currently as commercial buildings were actually designed as a residential building, and that too 20 to 25 years ago. Now they are not in a condition due to the exposure conditions to withhold even the residential things, and but commercial aspects are going on. For example, you must have seen that in the narrow roads of our colonies in the cities, there might be possibility that an entire school is running, entire coaching centers are running in a blocked area. If I talk about the capital city and also the capital city of Rajasthan, there are many various coaching institutes. You might have heard about them, you might have seen them, you might have studied there. So you have seen hundreds of 100, 200, 300 students. They are allowed to sit in a particular hall. Have you seen that particular measures are taken? That what to do in case there is a panic, in case there is an earthquake or a fire? Rarely we see the placement of fire extinguishers. Rarely we see that proper exit mechanisms are developed during in such a public place where huge mobility of students and public is going on. Now consider a mall. Now a mall is designed since it a proper standards and regulations have been made and adopted. So standards and regulations include provisions of various fire extinguishers, provisions of risk assessment in terms of earthquake and other things, provision of adopting standards and regulations in terms of assessing that whether if the entire mall or any public place is filled, let it be cinema theater, whether in a particular amount of time the entire hall could be evacuated or not. Okay, so adopting standards and regulations are definitely very important for coordination and disaster preparedness. Next, we have organizing communication and response mechanism. Now, let us consider a situation of Bhuj earthquake. So it occurred although more than 15 years back, but it was one of the worst disasters that our country has faced. And why I'm taking that example is because most of us are aware about the proceedings that happened after that. So during the earthquakes, we couldn't do much, because earthquake is not that for long duration. It is a very short spanned activity. But once the earthquake has happened and the damages have been done, what happens? The communication systems and the response mechanisms, mainly the communication systems are lost. How communication systems are lost? Firstly, there might be possibility that even the roads are broken, the telecommunication towers are broken, the phone lines are damaged. So in that particular situation, what should be the mechanism to respond to the needs? We need to identify quickly that whether in the broken structures, is there anyone alive? We need to take out them safely and provide hospitals for that particular thing. So definitely organizing the communication and response mechanisms in a case of disaster plays an important role. Next, we need to ensure that all resources are ready and easily mobilized. Now for this, let us take an easy example of a fire department. Now again, as a civil engineer in the subject of environmental engineering, in which we teach the students and we learn that what are the various things that we need to consider while determining demand for water supply in a particular city. So even in that, we consider a considerable amount of that water as fire demand. We term it as FD. So fire stations play an important role. They are strategic, they are located strategically according to the population and the compactness and all you can consider. So these resources are ready and they are always kept in the ready mode, and since the fire might occur at any time and SOS call might come at any time from anywhere, so the firemen are always ready for the action. Next, we have developing public education programs. So such as this program, this might also be developed under the disaster management guidelines for our state. So developing public education programs will definitely enhance the learning and most importantly, multi-sectoral participation. Now, as a mechanical engineer, you have chosen the elective of open elective of disaster management. So definitely there might be some interests and might be some motivations. And definitely as a developed mechanical engineer, graduate of mechanical engineering, you also need to take care in your industry, in your offices, that whether everything is working under safe condition or not. For example, many a times we hear accidents about machines failure, in which due to some or other problem, some accident might occur and the laborers or the chain engineers or chain men, they lose their life or they might lose their part of a body or might be hand or leg due to some of the other preventive measures that they have not taken. So definitely assessing the risks involved in that particular industry is important for you also. And once you are aware, you can definitely aware others as well, those who are working below you and above you. Next, the point is to coordinate information with news media. So during the case of disasters, news media plays a very significant role. So for example, let us take a very recent example of a cloud storm burst of Kedarnath that happened in Uttarakhand. So if you can remember, there was continuous proceedings on news media on how and what the NDRF and SDRF teams are doing, what the army is doing to save the people who are alive and also to find out all the deceased bodies and all. So the most important thing news media can play, for example, that was a tourist place, that was a temple for and also a tourist spot at which people from all over the nation, they go as a devotee to pray and to visit the Kedarnath temple. So what happened? First of all, the connection was lost. Connection was lost mainly between the people who were alive and might not be in a good situation, and along with their families. So their family members might have been worried. So what news media people do, they act as a mediator and they also display information regarding the proceedings, who are alive and not, and what are the lists, how the people can contact the various administrative authorities, how things can work flawlessly in terms of communication, since the major communication systems were destroyed at that time. So these were some of the aspects of these points. Moving ahead, let us discuss about medical preparedness and mass casualty management. So developing and capacity building of medical team specifically for trauma and psychosocial care. So as this I discussed in the first lecture, I believe, in which I said that post disaster, a lot of people who have even survived the disaster, they go through a huge amount of trauma, or we can say depressive behavior and all, in which their emotional health gets deteriorated. Now, because of this, because of that, all that panic that they have seen and gone through, the deaths of various people that they have seen, the situation of their mental health is not very good. So we need to develop and build capacities in terms of our medical teams, in which we can definitely assess these people who are facing psychosocial needs and also facing traumas post-disaster. Next, mass casualty management and triage. So what does this mean? That in case of mass casualties, that is, the number of diseased people is huge. So how does state will manage, first of all, as a societal individual, we need to understand that in case one of the members of a family is lost in a particular situation in which he was in a disaster, it may be natural or man-made, so the entire family panics. And in case there is a mass casualty, so there might be possibility. Let us take an example. Let us take an example of a recent case from our state of Rajasthan as well. Let us take an example of Jodhpur city. Yeah. So in Jodhpur city, what happened a few years back? You might have heard about the fort of Mehrangarh fort of Jodhpur. So in that there is a particular temple, and that is a temple which is highly worshipped, and during the Navratri season, a lot of devotees visit there, even in the early mornings. So due to some structural failure and some panic, the panic was created, and a stampede was as a result, stampede was created, and in which around 200 plus people lost their life. So this was a scene of mass casualty, and in terms of mass casualty management, we need to see and we need to firstly see that how do we identify the deceased bodies? Are they in a suitable condition to be delivered to their families? If not, what are the things that we need to do? For the deceased bodies for whom the families were not able to come up, then what we need to do for them? So all these things include definitely require training under mass casualty management programs. So moving on to the next one, we need to determine the casualty handling capacity of all hospitals and formulate appropriate treatment procedures. So as I discussed about the Gujarat Bhuj earthquake, so in that also the casualty was the effect was on the large scale of people, and we are not very much prepared in terms of hospitals. Like, let us take an example of a very recent, that's a coronavirus issue. So what has happened? The number of people who have been affected by coronavirus are increasing at a very high rate. And there was a situation when the hospital beds were full. Surely, it is not possible that we build entire hospitals within a very short span of time, in which and also the rate of affected people are increasing at even a higher rate. So definitely, appropriate measures and procedures for treatment were created, and now as we can see, home isolation is the first norm that is suggested for corona patients. And firstly, initially they are said that to handle the capacity of all hospitals, we need to give preference who are in a critical situation, and for them ventilators and other things must be supplied. Whereas for all those who are not in a critical situation and can handle themselves, for initial period at their households, so all these patients, as we know, they have been sent to home isolation system. Next, we have involvement of private hospitals. So again, during this pandemic, we can see that even the private hospitals, there has been a considerable limit on how much fees they can charge, medical fees they can charge for the corona patients. We need to also assess that all these private hospitals are maintaining the standards of quality. So involvement and complete devotion from all these different stakeholders, such as public and private hospitals, is a must in building up capacities in case of handling the various casualties. Next, we have care centers that can function as medical units. So there are multiple primary health centers, there are care centers, there are small dispensaries even, which have the essential needs to work in case of disaster. So let us visualize the situation of again of Bhuj earthquake. So if any of the care centers or primary health centers in the nearby villages or the nearby areas would have survived, then the people who needed the immediate attention in terms of medical, all of them could be sent to their particular centers in which proper care could have been taken. Next, again, it becomes important to identify the structural integrity and the approach routes. So I've already discussed about how structural integrity of the various infrastructure aspects can be found out in the previous slide, where I discussed about various tests which can be conducted. Now, based upon this, try to think a situation, don't think about the situations that are working currently, prevailing currently. Consider a situation of flood. What are the medical preparedness measures that should be taken in case there is a flood in your city? So, as a disaster management administrator, what will be the measures that you might be taking as a authority for disaster management? So think about it, try to visualize the problem. You can discuss with your friends that what all measures should be developed. Now, there might be a similar question even in your university exam, in which it is asked to develop a hypothesis or develop a strategy of medical preparedness and management of disaster. And a particular type of disaster might be given in the problem. Now, moving on ahead, let us start our discussion on disaster response systems. So, immediate reaction to the disaster, as a disaster is anticipated or soon after it begins, in order to assess the needs, to reduce the sufferings of the people, to limit the spread and the consequences of the disaster, and to open up the ways of rehabilitation. The methods that are included involves the mass evacuation strategy, next search and rescue. Mass evacuation I have already discussed earlier. Search and rescue, like let us take this example in which a fire has taken place in a particular floor of that building. Now, there might be possibility that there are some survivors there who might be panicking there, and due to lack of oxygen, they might be in a situation of just falling apart. So, in that case, what our team could do using their gears, they can get into this area. First of all, one of the teams could try to reduce the intensity of fire. Second team could work as search and rescue and find the people who are still alive and who could be saved. Next, emergency medical services. So, emergency medical services must be well up to date. Hospitals should have vacant beds in such a situation, so that can be used for emergency services providing to these people. And for that, administrators need to reach out to the nearby hospitals and inform the authorities to arrange the desired needs as per situation. Next, we have securing food and water. So, this especially becomes important in case of floods like situation, and the securing food and water, which is drinkable definitely, is very important. Many a times the rural people are not able to secure or store foods in a very good or high quantity for maybe a week or two. So in that case, you might have seen in various situations that army or the teams of National Disaster Relief Forces, they deliver food packets to all these affected people. For example, recently I was seeing a news based on Northeast where floods are prevailing. So the SDRF, that is the State Disaster Relief Force, and NDRF along with various personnel have been working together, firstly to search and rescue people to rehabilitate them through a safer location, secondly to deliver food packets and drinkable water to all these people. Next, maintaining law and order. So in this, policing plays a very important role. As we know that various mindsets work in our society, and some of them might not be very positive about the happening, so they might find an opportunity to create chaos, to create theft from the people who have deceased or are in a bad situation. They might start looting the various shops or different things. So maintaining law and order in such a situation plays a very important role. So let us again take the example of recent case of COVID-19. So even in this, we all know that during the initial lockdown periods, 1, 2 and 3, and even the fourth one, so maintaining law and order, that none of us, we go out into the public and get exposed to COVID. So it was a very critical issue then, and maintaining law and order was the primary concern of the administrators at that time, along with the definitely the priority being given to the health concerns of the COVID positive patients. So in such a way, disaster response systems can be developed, and if any question comes up in such a way, then you can definitely answer using the points I have discussed, and also based upon your experiences and the readings which we have done. Next, in the next lecture, we will be discussing about disaster impact and response. It will include the search, rescue, first aid and various things, identification procedures. We will be discussing some more issues with regard to disaster management. So that's all for this lecture. Try to formulate that problem that I have given, that to visualize, discuss it with friends on what are the things that we can do as preparing a medical response system in case of floods. So that's all for this lecture. See you in the next one.